Good morning, everyone. My name is Sophie Rivaud from Banque de France. It is a great pleasure for me to chair this session on the internationalization of the renminbi and its consequences for the international monetary system. Two great papers are going to be presented in our session. Just a quick remark before we start. Each paper presentation will last 20 minutes. I will tell the speaker when he has 2 minutes left. It will be followed by a 10-minute discussion, and then we will have 5 minutes for Q&As. Without further ado, let me introduce our first speaker, Edwin Lai from HK UST, who is going to speak, among other things, about the importance of capital account openness and financial development for renminbi internationalization. Edwin, you have 20 minutes and the floor is yours.
Well, let me try to share the screen with you. Can you see it?
Yes.
Can everybody see this? Okay. So if I try to do a full screen, okay, I hope everybody can see this. So this is this paper itself is a joint work with Isabel Yan of City University of Hong Kong. So I have to say that this paper is in fact more or less like the chapter 8 of this book that I just published. This book is just published in September 2021 by Cambridge University Press. It's called One Currency, Two Markets, China's Attempt to Internationalize the renminbi. So what I'm presenting today is basically like the chapter 8 of this book, which is about, the potential of the renminbi as a significant payment currency. Just let me just say that this book is actually available all over. It's in Amazon and all sorts of places. If you want to read the book without paying for it, it's also possible. You could go to my personal website. You can actually download the accepted manuscript of the book for free if you do it for research purposes. So just visit my personal website and you can get download the book accepted manuscript at zero cost. Okay, so without further ado, let me just talk about the book itself. Actually talk about many things. It talks about the importance of capital account opening, the importance of financial development, and also about the importance of the offshore market, and so on. And then finally, I talk about the prospects of RMB internationalization. But in this talk, I only focus on chapter 8, which is as I said, about the potential of the renminbi. So we know that China is trying to internationalize the renminbi, and we know that an international currency in general serves three purposes: unit of account, medium of exchange, and store of value. And I'm focusing on the medium of exchange function, which is the use of the currency for international payments. Luckily, I actually got a data set, international payment data set from SWIFT, and I use it to perform a gravity model kind of analysis. And then based on that model, I carry out some counterfactual experiments to predict the potential of the renminbi as a significant payment currency. Should China's capital account become more open, or its financial market becomes broader, deeper, and more liquid? So the methodology I use is a gravity model to explain the bilateral flows of payments by currency between country pairs. The rationale for using the gravity model is just as usual, because we feel that these payments are for settlement of real economic activities, as well as for some interbank financial transactions. And these should logically follow some sort of gravity pattern because theoretically all these activities should be possibly related to economic sizes of the sender and receiver countries and negatively related to flow friction such as distance. So in trade, it is well known that distance would be a friction, and also common colonial heritage will reduce the friction. Common legal system will reduce the friction. For financial flow, we also conjecture that similar kind of process mechanism is in play. Concerning the choice of currency, we conjecture that it's going to be affected by a set of currency specific factors, which I'm going to explain below. So if you look at the to give you some preview of the results in case I run out of time, we find that the value of the bilateral payment flow between two countries denominated in a given currency is significantly and negatively affected by distance, but significantly and positively affected by things like the GDP of the origin and destination country, the trade share between the issuing country and the origin and destination country, the GDP share of the issuing country, the co-movement, and also something which I think I want to emphasize here is the innovation of this paper, which is something called the share ratio, which is the ratio of the foreign exchange turnover share of the currency to the GDP share of the issuing country, which is strongly correlated with both the capital account openness and the level of financial development of the issuing country. So we conjecture that the share ratio, as well as the GDP share of the issuing country, together determine the market thickness of the currency, and higher market thickness increases the attractiveness of the currency to be used as a medium of exchange due to network externalities. So we also incorporate fixed effects, origin or the sender country fixed effect, destination country fixed effect, and the year fixed effect. And these fixed effects will capture characteristics of the countries that will attract payments or make the country more relevant as a sender country. Okay, so basically this is the idea. And then we also carry out some kind of factual thought experiment to predict the payment share of the renminbi as China's capital account become more open and financial sector become more developed. So to give you a preview of the result, we we just do some kind of counterfactual thought experiment to see if China's level of financial development and openness increases to that of Mexico in 2016, then China's then the renminbi will become actually the third payment currency with a payment share of 9% compared with the US dollar, which is 47 and 20% for the euro. But on the other hand, if China's level of financial development openness remains unchanged, but its GDP increases to that of the US, the renminbi will only be the sixth payment currency with a payment share of only 2.4%. So in other words, this simple thought experiment basically says, tells you that an increase in the level of financial development openness will be much more important than an increase in the economic size of China for renminbi to become a significant global payment currency. So basically, this is the idea that the whole paper is just centered around this idea. So it's a little bit, it's not as broad as in the previous session. We have people, the speakers talking more broadly about things. If you want to look at a more broad picture, please refer to my book. It has a much broader picture of the entire RMB internationalization. So the other thought experiment that I try to do is to try to predict the future. I try to predict that, by the year 2030, what will be, the payment share of the renminbi. And I get the outcome that if China's level of financial development and openness become approximately that of Thailand in 2016, then the renminbi will become a distant third payment currency with a payment share of about 6.6%, compared with 54.8% for the US dollar and 16.4% for the euro. So you can see that, well, you know, that actually, you know, for China to achieve that level is actually not that easy, as you will see. But on the other hand, if China's financial development and openness does not change, then it, you know, it will only, you know, the payment share will only stay at the very low level, even by 2030. So again, it's sort of, you know, get back my, back to my original point, which is that, you know, the size of the GDP alone doesn't really catapult the renminbi into the league of major currency, but its financial development openness, that is more, much more important. So basically, that's the result of the paper. And because of time, I don't really have time to talk about the literature, gravity model in international payment flow, international financial flow, is discussed by Portes and Ray. And then there's people like Okawa and Van Winkle talk about gravity in international finance, and so on and so forth. We focus on gross flows, not net flows. That's why we use a gravity model. So basically, let me be very quick here. This is basically the gravity model. The left-hand side is the payment flow, lot of payment flow from I to J in trillion US dollar denominated in the currency curve, if the flow is non-zero. And the right-hand side, you have the GDP of the sender country, and then the GDP of the receiver country. You have a sender fixed effect, which is constant over time, receiver fixed effect, and then you have a vector of factors that inhibit payment flow, such as distance, and so on and so forth. And then we have a set of factors that affect currency choice, such as the trade share of issuing country in the sender country's trade, in the destination, in the receiver country's trade, co-movement between the currency and the sender country currency, and the co-movement with the destination country. And then one very important variable, which I have emphasized before, which is called the share ratio, which is the ratio of the currency foreign exchange turnover share to GDP share of the issuing country. And it turned out to be a very significant, variable. And then there's other things like the issuing country's GDP share, which gives you the size. So you can sort of think of the share ratio as the financial development and openness, whereas the GDP is the size. So it's the size of the country interacting with the financial development and openness that would give rise to a major, to the status of a major payment currency. And the, you know, a case in point is the US as well as the Eurozone. And then you have the time dummy and so on. So the data that we use is just, you know, the empty, the SWIFT data set. We use the customer initiated payments as well as institution initiated. Okay, so it includes payment based on real activities as well as some financial flows, interbank financial flows. And in fact, interbank financial flow consists of much larger percentage of this data set. It's 90%. Okay, so we have 13 countries, 13 currencies, and these payments are for settlement of real economic activities, as well as for foreign exchange transaction and other interbank financial transactions. So if you just look at something more interesting here, if you look at the data, this is a foreign exchange turnover share from BIS, and you can see over the years, you know, 1995 all the way to 2019, you said that the US, for example, I have normalized this to, you know, summing up to 100, and the US dollar is, you know, by far the, you know, that have the largest foreign exchange turnover share, about 45, 44%, the euro around 16%, much, much lower. Renminbi is really disproportionately small. As you can see, it was really tiny from 1998, but even in 2019, it was very small, disproportionately. And I'm going to say that it's because of its low capital account openness and financial development. If you look at GDP share, of course, the China is very high. By 2019, it's already 16% of the global. United States, 24. The euro area, in fact, is actually smaller than China in terms of the GDP share of the world. But if you look at this so-called share ratio, which is my variable, my favorite variable, for the US dollar is 1.81, euro is 1.06, but the renminbi is much, much lower. It's reflecting very low level of financial development and openness. So this is basically to provide you with evidence that this share ratio is indeed strongly correlated with financial development and capital account openness. So it's the regression results. So here is just a hypothesis testing, of the gravity model. And you see that the gravity model really works very significantly if you aggregate over all the currency. If you just, regardless of currency, just look at the total flow, gross flow, bilateral inter-country flow, you have the GDP of the origin, GDP of the destination, distance enter negatively, constant, and so on and so forth. So if you look at by currency, it's also very significant. You have the, this is origin GDP, destination GDP. This share ratio, as I said, my favorite variable, capturing financial development and openness, very significant in 1% level. And then we have this distance enter as negative, very significantly, GDP share of the issuing country, signifying the size of the issuing country. This is all very consistent with our hypothesis. And then we carry out counterfactuals using this slightly different equation just to make the prediction. Okay, if you look at this in the year 2016, if you look at this, the actual payment share of the US dollar is 55% versus the euro 20%. The renminbi is 1.62% here. The model that I use, actually can, reproduce this shares very accurately. So this is just to show you that as a as an in-sample prediction is very, very good. And then if you look at the counterfactual experiments, I'm going to just to say that this first counterfactual is to tell you, in 2016, the renminbi foreign exchange turnover share increases so that its share ratio increases to that of, 2.36 times. Then the renminbi payment share will increase from 1.6 something to 4.2 something. If its share ratio is 4.8 times, then its payment share becomes a lot higher, becomes the third one. So if you look at, on the other hand, if this GDP in 2016 becomes out of the US, it doesn't really make much of a dent in terms of its payment share. It's just, GDP doesn't really make much difference. So then the next thing I want to talk about is this so-called counterfactual D, which is to predict the future. So what we do is I want you to look at this slide. This is the prediction of the payment shares of countries in 2030, that's about 9 years later. We assume that, starting from 2016, China's GDP grows at 5.5% per year, US and 2.5%, Eurozone 1.5, UK 1.5, Australia 3, and so on and so forth. And then we look at two scenarios. One is that when RMB's share ratio remains unchanged, meaning that its financial development openness remains unchanged at the 2016 level, then you can see that, you know, the renminbi payment shares is not going to change very much from 1.6 to 2.6 to the 6.1. But if its payment share becomes that of even the Thai baht, which is a developing country, then the renminbi will already become a third payment currency at 6.6, below that of the US dollar and euro. And the US dollar is still going to be a dominant payment currency by far, and then the euro is still the second one, but the renminbi will become a third one, you know, but
sorry, Edwin, you have 2 minutes left.
Very good. So I think basically I'm almost done. Basically, this is the conclusion that the gravity model works very well, and also, you know, you know, it works very well in the even this pay currency choice gravity model, and most importantly, financial development openness of the issuing country positively affect bilateral payment flow denominated in currency between two countries, such as parents. The increase in level of financial development openness is distinctly more important than increase in economic size of China for renminbi to become a significant global payment currency. Now, I actually, at the end, I actually wanted to talk a little bit about the Belt and Road Initiative and the central bank digital currency, which is actually not part of the paper, but the fact that, you know, people are interested about RMB internationalization. I just want to report to you that some of this result is in the book, but not in this paper, which is that I find that the Belt and Road Initiative is not going to, not much effect. It does not have much effect on the status of the renminbi as a payment currency or the currency to denominate international debt category. In other words, the Belt and Road Initiative is not going to make the renminbi a major payment currency. And the central bank digital currency, well, as Raphael actually discussed, does not is probably not going to facilitate the RMB internationalization. So this is all I want to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Edwin. You have been right on time. So now let's turn to Clément Marcillier from Banque de France. You have 10 minutes, Clément, for the discussion.
Thanks a lot. Share my slides. Working? Yeah. Okay, so let me I'm going to not be that long because, as you say, usual European paper are kind of really intuitive and basically it works, the new setup works. It's just kind of a scheme of your setup, but first of all, the paper was well written and very didactic, and you can appreciate it because the introduction is about four or five pages. Something like that, and really explain all of your methodology and the different contribution basically of the paper. So basically here on the top of the slide, basically that's your model. So you choose to you want to model trade. We want to model payment flows by considering that those payments. The counterparty of those payments are only related to trade or investment, and that's the main assumption. And then using that game of the paper, using a gravity model, you try to model bilateral flows aggregated first over all currencies and then by currencies. And your last point, the last section of the paper is to use your results for providing some scenarios for China. Here are the three main takeaways that you just summarized during our conclusion. That has about, I would say again, like very very intuitive. So first thing, the economic size of partner matters, makes sense, and also the distance. So basically, that justifies the use of the Darwin's model. So again, okay, that you show that using the Darwin's models in your, you show that your setup is working. Then the second thing is that that is important looking at the occurrence flows is that the strength of the trade relationship, the financial development and open index that you use are important in your setup. And basically, and then the third point, which is provided by your scenario, is that perhaps the most important takeaways. Even if the China carry on growing on in terms of GDP without any significant change in the level of financial development and openness, basically the renminbi won't become a significant global payment currency. That would make sense, but at least you documented it and you justify it. Then a few things to me that perhaps you could add it or emphasize, because and actually you said it in the presentation, the share ratio of the groups are one of the main important contributions of the paper. That would be interesting perhaps to compare it with some other capital openness indices, obviously the one of Shiniko, but also the one of Ashina and others. Also analyzing the share ratio would be interesting on its own, and some charts, analyzing these trends would be very interesting, and we can relate it to the recent IPF literature provided by the IMF. Then also, and because it's clearly one of the most valuable of the paper, is your database. So you say that during the presentation that it's a database you add by paying Swift, but that would be, if possible, again, interesting to see what really those Swift messages that is in the content box really shows, and what if we really are able to distinguish what are the reasons related to payments, and again, it's very related with your assumption of payments are only the counterpart of some trade or investment. Also, some descriptive statistics, again, it's possible to be nice, because it's, I guess it's really that. Then, of course, a big limit would be dancing with writing GIS piano order survey, and perhaps even with the upcoming GIS survey, but I don't know if that could be feasible with your Swift data set. And then I would perhaps pair to all the copynets on trading voicing, because it's one of the most important contributions to the literature over the last decade in this field, and that would be interesting to see and what are the views and how you relate with this literature that your result with this literature. Hope that was one of the main results of late papers of Gutenberg is that they showed that the increase in trading voicing in both dollar and euro is not follow the same trend that euro area and US. So basically, which is declining. So how you, because it's interfering with your results. So how you manage those numbers? Some caveats and some ideas for the problem that I've not read in the paper. there is some problem with the Chinese data, mainly about way Chinese activity is estimated. So we can think of the 2015-2016 Chinese slowdown that is probably more pronounced in reality that is registered in the official figures. So perhaps trying some other indicator would be interesting, indication index or some other, I don't know. And again, balance of payment data, we saw that recently from crisis of 2015, the largest item of the balance of payment is now error and omissions. So how we deal with that is only the counterpart of trade and FDI flows or portfolio flows are not in the Chinese place. Are we missing something? So there is a lot of papers from the Reserve Bank of Australia on that, and I don't know, perhaps just seem to go across the big data something like that. And as you say, so basically in your setup, is your setup there is only 13 countries. Can you perhaps increase the size of the virtual of this panel? I don't know, because that would be definitely perhaps actually you said it during your conclusion. Is the Belt and Road countries initiative countries are interesting to include in your setup? Do you affect the results, I think? And then as we said again in the conclusion, basically the cryptocurrencies on the ECNY are game changer. Are they ready? So that's the question, open question, and that's what you say during your but I let you respond if you want. I the last slide on give some idea about the structure, but it's more I can say you if you want.
Okay. Thank you very much, Clément, and sorry everyone, the sound was not very great. We will try to improve this for the rest of the day. We can now open the floor to a few questions. You can raise your virtual hand or you can step in directly.
Hello, everyone. Maybe I can just break the ice. Very interesting paper, Edwin, on this internationalization of RMB and capital flows. Actually, I want to ask you, and also probably Clément, a question which follows up the previous panel discussion. So actually, Alicia mentioned this idea of, you know, using offshore RMB markets to foster internationalization of RMB. So China is sort of, if we think about the Mondial Fleming model, is sort of in the middle, right? It's not a corner solution, but it's a sort of interior solution for China. So while maintaining onshore markets relatively closed, they use offshore markets for internationalization. So to what extent this is sustainable or it will be the case actually looking forward, what China will need to at some points open up the onshore markets. We already see signs, right? I mean, with the bond connect, so there are more and more connections with the rest of the world. So I'd like to have your view and putting your framework into the practice. Thank you.
So I see that Julia wants to ask a question. Have raised your hand.
Yeah, hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
I hear myself. I'm just wondering, you have a lot of fixed effects in that model And since you're doing this exercise where, you know, what would happen if GDP went up? And we know that a lot of these currency shares are actually very stable over time, which is in your fixed effects. So what you're picking up are very small movements at the margin, probably, because you're exploiting this time series variation. And I'm wondering what that would imply for your counterfactual exercise. If we're able to pick up these long-term trends, which take a lot of time until maybe then there's a regime shift and it's you know, changing suddenly. But yeah, if you could just elaborate on this.
We also have a question from Jinglong Yahoo.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Thanks very much for the amazing presentation. And I want to ask a more basic question about the incentive of China to introduce this internationalization of renminbi. I mean, the basic question is, why does China want to do that? This might sound a naive question, but we think about the dilemma, trilemma in the international economics. If we have more capital account openness, then this might suggest less independence of the PBOC's monetary policy. So if suggested by Edwin, if we want to internationalize the renminbi, we emphasize, and the most important point is the increased openness of the capital account openness, for instance, and why does China want to do that if we have this compromise of the independence of monetary policy? So does China want to wield the exorbitant privilege as emphasized by Ancient Green, or is there any other incentive for China to do that? Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So Edwin, if you want to answer some of the question.
Yes,
a few minutes.
Can I just answer the questions of the people who asked the question after the discussion, right? So the first one is Gong Cheng. About using the offshore RMB market as a driver for RMB internationalization, I do not think that is possible. I do not think that you can just use the offshore RMB market as a driver, as a main driver of RMB internationalization. It's not going to succeed. As in my book, I already actually clearly, that's why you have to read my book. My book actually is clearly says that, you know, the most important thing, actually, as same thing as I emphasize in the paper, you need to have financial development and you need to have capital account openness. And these have to be happening in the onshore market. So these are two, of course, the third one is, you know, the size of the economy, which China already has. You know, the fourth factor would be, foreigners' trust of the Chinese system, which is a little bit more, you know, non-economic. Let's just focus on financial development and capital account openness. They are necessary, and therefore, if they don't open these two aspects and just try to develop the offshore RMB market, it's not going to help. This actually is very clear when you back in 2015. When China imposed capital control on capital outflow, because of the crisis, you know, so-called crisis 2015 summer, the Hong Kong offshore market basically was destroyed. So the offshore market was basically greatly harmed by the capital control of the onshore market. So in other words, this actually illustrates my point. You know, you just rely on the offshore market to be totally convertible and the onshore market to be partly convertible, and that you cannot hope the for the currency to be internationalized. So that's the first question. The second question is Camille's question. It's a very, very good question. I can only say that I tried my best. I understand that you may be concerned about how robust is my estimate, right? For example, I get the result that, you know, China's payment share by 2030 will become 6.6%. If I, you know, make the certain assumption and then carry out the counterfactual, you may worry about the robustness of that. I sympathize with your view. What I could do is to, you know, just try different specification and see how much the number changes. As far as I see, I did not see much change to the number of 6.6% by 2030. And I guess I would not, I mean, I would not take the 6.6% too seriously, except to just to actually illustrate the point that, you know, the GDP actually has less effect than capital account openness and financial development. I mean, just to look to just compare the two things, you see that the impact of GDP, you know, even if China China's GDP is equal to that of the US by exchange rate conversion, it's not going to change the payment share of China a great deal. Okay, that's the one thing. But if you make China's share ratio increase by, you know, twice, you know, to that of Thailand, it actually had a big, much bigger impact. So that's just my point. But I think it's a very good question. In fact, I should maybe advertise a little bit that I'm actually writing a sequel of this paper with Keith Head and my co-author. We're going to have a more sophisticated gravity model, a two-layer gravity model with the currency choice, two-layer. So that's the current situation. Okay. So the last question about the incentive for China to internationalize its renminbi. Now, this is a very, very good question. Again, I answer this question in my book. If you read the book, you understand a lot more what of the motivation. That there are actually multiple motivation, in my opinion. The most important of them, one of them is so-called monetary sovereignty. Monetary sovereignty, which is that China wants to be independent, from the foreign currencies and foreign countries jurisdiction. In particular, here we talk about the United States, which we find that, you know, China's in a particularly special kind of situation because it has a ideological differences with the West, has a different system than that of the West. So it's in some sense it's a mistrust of the Western dominated or US dollar dominated international monetary system. And China wants to have more independence from it. And therefore it wants to not to have to rely too much on the US dollar. And the US dollar related payment system. The arrest of the Huawei's chief financial officer in Canada is actually a case in point, that because she the Huawei actually used big use of the US dollar payment system, and therefore it flouted US law and therefore was arrested. And so China didn't want that to happen again. And also that's monetary sovereignty. But also another thing is actually related to that is that China really wants to use the renminbi in all its international transactions. Okay, So, for example, it wants to be able to denominate its trade or settle its trade in renminbi and in international borrowing and lending. It also wants to use renminbi to do that in the long run, so that you know, if you're able to you know, lend internationally in renminbi, then you would you will not have this so-called original sin problem, as explained by Barry Eichengreen. And that may actually be a very important thing. And to actually lend and borrow internationally in renminbi is actually an aspiration of China. So that and also of course with the political influence.
I'm sorry, yeah. Edwin, but we really have to move on right now. So.
Okay, so I'm done.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm sorry. So now let me introduce our second speaker, Cédric T, from the Graduate Institute of Geneva, who is going to speak about the importance of fundamentals versus policies in the invoicing of international trade. Cédric, you have 20 minutes, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Sophie. Thanks to the organizer for the opportunity to present this work. So let me share my screen. Second. Okay. And you should now have it in full screen. Yeah. Good. Very good. So this is a joint work with Georgios Gorgadis, Elena Lemezzo, and Arnaud Mel, the ECB. So of course, the usual disclaimer applies that this is in no way the ECB's view. So let me start by motivating the question. So a lot of the first points have been put out already this morning, that we have the central role of the US dollar in international transactions. We have talked a lot about finance and the FX reserve. In this paper, we are going to focus on the trade dimension and more specifically the invoicing of transactions. So in which price are goods that are shipped across borders set? And that what we see is that the dollar has a big role, even in transactions between so-called third countries. That means where the US is neither the destination nor the origin. And that nearly half of the world trade is in dollar. And this has led to the emergence of the so-called dominant currency pricing paradigm, which have several impacts on international transmission, and Gita Gopinath and co-authors have written extensively about it. So the question here is this something that we should think of as set in stone, or can it evolve? And if it can evolve, why? Now, many papers point that inertia is quite strong, so it may not be set in stone, but very persistent. And the reason is simply one of strategic complementarity. We may all want to move to another system, but nobody wants to be the first to move and be left standing alone. And Dmitry Mukin, in recent work, put this into a fully specified macro model. What we do in this paper is think of, you know, if we move, who would be the challenger? So there's two currencies we can think of. One is that is large, that's the euro, and one that is still small but growing, and that's the renminbi. And what we want to look at is what are the factors that underpin the presence of these challenger currencies. And in particular, can policy has an effect about it? So what we do and what we find, we rely on a broad data set of invoicing that covers 20 years of data. So these are data at the annual frequency at the level of country for export and import. So for instance, it will tell us that X percent of export from Colombia are invoiced in dollars. It is not bilateral, so we don't know export to which country, and it is not broken down by sectors. This is essentially building on the earlier work that both Kazas Gorgadis and Amezo Gopinath and Mel have done. And again, so this is the database that they use on the invoicing. What this paper does is extend it to a few more countries, but also introduce information on renminbi. The database has 115 countries for which we know what is invoiced in dollar, euro, or the country's currency. But for 53 of this country, we also know how much is invoiced in renminbi. And that's going to be the focus on our China analysis. What we do is we run panel regressions of invoicing with time and country fixed effects. So country fixed effects are quite demanding here, because effectively whatever we identify would be along the time series dimension, which is putting the bar quite high, because usually people have found that the time series dimension is not so rich, that invoicing is inertial, and most of the dispersion is across country, but this would be absorbed by country fixed effect. So we really put the focus on how invoicing evolves as opposed to what its steady state level is. We look at the role of economic fundamental and policy, and by policy, what we mean, and it really applies to China, is a swap line set by the People's Bank of China. So in a nutshell, what we find, fundamentals matter, surprisingly, for euro and dollar. And what we mean by fundamental is country size. So the bigger you are, the more your currency is used. The nature of goods. So if you have goods that are more homogeneous, say commodities, but also industrial goods, you tend to voice in dollar. And this fundamental doesn't matter so much for the renminbi, actually. Turning to policy, swap lines can raise renminbi use, but this is not automatic. It requires that a fair amount of trade takes place with China. So even though the paper covers both euro, dollar, and renminbi, in this presentation, given the limited time, I will focus more on what we deal with renminbi, which is also closer in spirit to the conference main topic. One thing I want to flag clearly is renminbi invoicing, as you'll see, is still in the early stages. So the evidence we present today is by no means the last word. We view it really as a first necessarily preliminary look at the situation. And it would be very interesting in coming years to see how the pattern evolves and whether the driver we find remains stronger or actually weakened a bit. Brief overview of the literature on invoicing. The early papers 10 years ago and more were focusing more on macro and sectoral drivers. But since then, with better and better data, the analysis has broadened to looking at features at the firm level or even the level of individual transactions. Couple of main points that have emerged is a complementarity, or what in a word with Linda Goldberg we call coalescing. And that's simply the strategic complementarity that a firm doesn't want to behave in a way that's too different from its competitor. Dennis Novi and several papers since have also looked at the dimension of hedging of cost. And that's relevant, for instance, with global value chain. If you buy a lot of your inputs from abroad and they're invoiced in, say, euro, well, that gives you a natural tendency to invoice also in euros. Microeconomic conditions matter. Essentially, country with more volatile macro fundamentals are less likely to see their currency used. An interesting paper, Gopinath and Stein, so connects the invoicing decision with what happened in financial market. And the level of individual transaction, research has shown that the size of individual transaction or the individual firm can also play a role. Some papers such as Mukin and Gopinath and other have demonstrated several times is the dominant role of a currency arise from complementarity. So if you want, a country may have a small fundamental advantage, but the fact that I use it make it more likely for you to use it, which reinforces my decision, and thus you get in the end something that is much bigger than what you would guess at first. In terms, this literature has not really looked at policy role for the simple reason that policy has never been very active in promoting international trade invoicing. One exception is China. And there's a very interesting recent paper by Bahaj and Rice, who look at the effect on China on the payment system. So relying on the SWIFT data. And the idea is if you make payment in a currency, you need your bank to accept it. So there are financial frictions. Well, if policy puts together some swap line to facilitate international banking activity in that currency, it makes the payment easier, and so you're more likely to use the currency. So Bar and Rice look really at the payment dimension of things. We will take a complementary role to look at the invoicing decision. Some stylized facts, and here I'm focusing on the renminbi use. So, you know, when we take the data set we have, the the broad data, so we increased some countries. In terms of the stylized facts about the usual suspects, I could say, the dollar and euro, we find what people have already found. The dollar has a big role, well bigger than you'd expect based on trade. Zooming in on the 53 countries for which we know whether invoicing is done in dollar, euro, the domestic currency and the renminbi, what we see is what has put in the chart below. The left panel shows you how many countries we actually report this. So you see that it's a growing sample and the similar evolution of the reporting for export and import. The right panel shows you that for this country, what is the share of invoicing in renminbi? The key point is it's small. Okay, it's less than 1%, basically. But let me point to other things. So the lines are going up. You know, one may argue not so much. But there are some countries for which the role is larger. So there's quite an amount of dispersion. And you can see that in the chart with a thin line that shows you the top quartile of the distribution. So the, looking at the renminbi, it's still early in the game, clearly, but it's something that is gaining traction. And so we think that it's worth taking a first look at it again, bearing in mind that our assessment is likely to evolve in coming years. What about the swap lines? So the PBOC has set a swap line with 41 foreign central banks. And what the swap lines are intended, unlike maybe the Fed swap line, which were more about handling the financial crisis, the swap lines are more aimed at promoting the international role. So it's very different from the ECB, which never really took an active role in promoting the international role of the euro. Here we have, for the first time really, to that extent in recent history, a central bank that is active in that game. So what we see, if you look on the first two chart at the top, you see the share of renminbi used in import and export, but constructing country with a swap line on the left and the country without. You clearly see that the line is higher with the swap line. Another thing which you can think of as an event study is the bottom chart. We look at time zero being the implementation of a swap line. And what does it do for the renminbi share? And what you see, it's initially doesn't do much, but after a few years, you see the swap, the invoicing share going up. So with this in mind, we turn to our econometric assessment. And what we do, the dependent variable is a share of a currency's overall export or import that are invoiced in a specific currency. Okay. And this share varies through time. Let me point to two important points. We put fixed effects. So we have country fixed effect, which means that any driver of invoicing that is time invariant will be absorbed by that. So our assessment is not whether a country, for whatever reason, always invoice more in renminbi, but if that country starts invoicing more than it used to in renminbi. So we really focus on the time dimension, which is making the exercise more challenging, because usually the standard view is that invoicing is quite inertial through time. And so the literature has focused more on the cross-sectional dimension. We control for whatever global factor is going on with the time fixed effect. And then we have several controls. So that first, that includes the geographical composition. The idea here is, for instance, that if you export more to the US, you would be more likely to use a dollar. We put a dummy for a country if you have a swap line, which of course only applies to the renminbi. Control for exchange rate movements also. And we also control also, that's more for the looking at the dollar on the euro, of whether you participate in global value chain and whether you export more homogeneous goods. Let me turn to results and first flagging the key result for dollar and euro, but I'll zoom in and more on the renminbi. We confirm many things that are known in the literature. Size matter. Okay, there's more dollar used in countries that export more to the US or to what we call the dollar block, meaning countries that have exchange rate pegged to the dollar. Okay. Similar finding for the euro. Homogeneity of goods matter. If in a country export more homogeneous goods, meaning commodities or industrial supplies, it will have a stronger coalescing effect, and that then goes to the dollar at the expense of the euro. This is something that the literature had already flagged. The role of global value chain is a bit more subtle. So we ask, are you a country for which you tightly connected on the import side to GVC? In other words, do you import a lot of your inputs? Yeah. Overall, we find little effect, some for the euro. Now, you may counter that global value chain per se shouldn't push you either way. It depends on global value chain with whom. So the geographical composition of the GVC will play a role. And to capture that, we interact the GVC with a share of import by region. So if you're a country importing more from the US and you are tightly connected to GVC, do you use more of the dollar on your export? And the idea is like imported inputs that are likely to be priced in dollar, I price my own exports in dollar. Indeed, that's the case. We find that US centered GVC support dollar. Same thing for Europe. Also, this is something that is more regional in nature. It's much more concentrated among European countries. Now, turning to the renminbi. So we first start looking at how the fundamental affect the renminbi use. We move to the swap line in a minute. What you see in red here is the role of the geographical composition. The question is, like, if you export more to China, do you use more renminbi or other currencies? The left part is about export, the right about imports. What we find is the effect on renminbi, column 3 or 7, is essentially nil. What you do, see, however, is you make more use of the dollar. So if you trade more with China, you tend to use more the dollar at the expense of the euro, possibly reflecting that for a long time, the renminbi didn't move so much against the dollar. Interestingly, this is quite heterogeneous across country. If you look at the bottom part, here we distinguish this effect depending on the country is European or not. And the effect for countries that are not European is highlighted in blue, and you see that's where really the effect is coming from. Okay. For European countries, you don't see that. If anything, for imports, you see an opposite effect. Now, digging deeper, China is a big player, but has also a regional contrast. It's really a big player among its neighbor. So we repeat this exercise, and instead of doing just Europe versus non-Europe, we go by regions. Okay. And what you see here, we're zooming on two regions, Southeast and East Asia in red and Oceania in blue. And what we find there is for this region, you start seeing trade being associated with a higher use of the renminbi. Okay, so that's column 3 and 7, especially on the import side, you start seeing a role on the export to some extent. And you still see for this region, the role of the dollar. Now, does policy help? Okay, so we put now the dummy with swap lines in this, and we do two things. We first put the dummy, but we also interact it with a share of exports going to China. What you see in blue is the effect of the dummy, the swap line per se is not significant or can even be negative, okay, for the renminbi. However, the interaction effect is there. You see that is a positive for the renminbi and a negative for the euro. Now, reading interaction just from the table is not so easy. So what I want to do there is show you the chart of the marginal effect depending on the trade share with China. The first thing here is for renminbi use. The left panel is for export, the right one for imports. What you have on the horizontal is a share of trade to China. And the dotted curve you see is the kernel density. So it gives you a sense of where countries are on that measure. The red line for each is the estimated total effect of the swap line, including the interaction. What you see is this can be positive. However, it really turns into positive territory for countries that have a substantial trade share with China. Most of the mass to the left wouldn't see that much. So do swap line helps? Yes, but it only helps in countries that are actually trading a lot with China. Now, if the renminbi tends to be supported, what is the effect on the other currencies? What we find if we do the same chart, but then look at the effect on the use of euro, you see this blue line. So it goes down. Okay, it initially is quite positive, but it goes down. So countries that trade a lot with China would move away from the euro because of the swap line. What about the dollar? That's this chart. You see, here's the effect are quite stable across the distribution. However, notice the scale. This effect tend to be negative. So interestingly, what we find is the adoption of swap line tends to have a negative effect on dollar invoicing, that it is actually not so dependent on the extent of trade. So what we could take from this is the swap line will displace away from the dollar some effect into the renminbi at the expense of euro, but these later two effects only for countries that trade a lot with China. So that brings me to my conclusion. Our question is, are invoicing patterns evolving? Now we have a new player, China. Does it matter? Yeah, it's early in the game, but it's worth looking at. And this is a complement to the existing literature was much more in cross-section. And we document that this, the use of renminbi is quite heterogeneous. Unsurprisingly, we find fundamental matter in favor already established currencies. So that essentially confirm what the literature has found. But policy also plays a role, and policy here is really about the RMB and the PBOC. Why? Because there is an explicit policy of promoting use, which was not the case at all for the ECB. And what we find is this can raise the use of the renminbi, but only when trade exposure to China is large. Caveat here, of course, the sample we look at remains narrow. The use of renminbi is still at the early stage. So view our evidence as a first look that is bound to evolve in coming years as new data come in. So it's a story to be followed. So that wraps my presentation. Thanks a lot. And I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Thank you very much, Cedric. So now let me turn to Gong Cheng from the BIS. Nice to see you again, Gong. You have 10 minutes for your discussion. We cannot hear you, Gong. I'm sorry, Gong, we cannot hear you.
Sorry, I was on mute. Can you hear me now?
Yes, perfectly.
Okay,
thank you.
And can you see my screen, the slides?
Yes, we can see your slides as well.
Okay. Thank you very much, Sophie, and also many thanks to the organizers for having invited me to this conference. And also, it's a pleasure to discuss this paper by Cedric and the other co-authors on the dollar's dominance in global trade, and also compared with other two currencies, the euro and the renminbi. So before I start, the disclaimer applies. So the views presented hereafter are those of mine and do not necessarily represent those of the BIS. So first of all, I really appreciated reading this paper. Well written, very insightful, and presented quite a lot of interesting empirical results to answer the key research question, which is what explains the USD dominance in international trade invoicing. And also, can trade-related fundamentals and policies foster use of another currency, such as the euro, put it in the paper as the large competitor and also an emerging competitor. The contributions just highlight very quickly. I think it's very interesting to explore further the rich data set on trade invoicing from both and co-authors 2020. And especially for this first attempt to use this subset on RMB invoicing for 38 countries for exports and 49 countries for imports. And I also largely appreciate this distinction between drivers, so about the drivers between trade related fundamentals and from policies such as swap lines. To just give a very quick summary of the empirical results and also that helped me to frame my questions. So you can see here on the one hand, you have fundamentals, and on the other, you have policies actually to foster use of a currency for international trade. So In this paper, of course, Cedric focused on the renminbi, but in the paper is much richer, so brings up quite a lot of results about the USD and also the euro. To give you a graphical recap of the story, so of course the size matters. So the more you trade with the United States and the euro area, the more you tend to use one or the other currency, also depending on the USD or euro blocks. The second one is pretty interesting, is in terms of homogeneity of goods. So the more a country trades homogeneous goods, the more it tends to use USD versus at the expense of the euro. This probably explains quite a lot about trade invoicing in emerging market economies that I'm going to comment later on. And of course, this global value chain, which is quite interesting, and once it is interacted with the size of imports, we see actually it promotes the use of euro. And finally, about China, and here the renminbi is brought in. So here, very interestingly, so as Cedric just mentioned, so probably the size of, if we control for the size of China, in terms of export destination or import source, actually the integration of China promotes the use of dollar. I think this to a large extent reflects the fact that China and also East Asia is to a large extent a dollar-based trading block. So quite a lot of intermediary goods and also commodities actually are denominated in dollars. And here I put two, as you can see for the euro and also RMB, they are double arrows. So depending on actually the sample we look at, as Cedric just mentioned, for instance, for Oceania and also for Southeast Asia. So there is an increase in the use of RMB conditional on the size of trading volume with China. So this is the whole, a lot of results about the fundamentals. Versus policy, so I'm going to come back on the two points I circled. On the other hand, so about the policies, so here there's only one policy that is examined in the scope of the paper, which is the swap line. And also swap lines are interacted with the size of imports from China. And we can see a positive relationship actually promoting the use of RMB. I will also come back on this point, basically from these two aspects, the fundamentals and versus policies. So here, one thing I want to comment is, as I said, so in this paper, the co-authors very well structured the results and to show that a higher share of homogeneous goods would raise use of USD at expense of the euro. And also more trades with China raises dollar use outside of Europe. I think this is a key point that has been also raised in the context, in the European context, when the European Commission started to think about the international role of the euro in 2018. So largely, I think the phenomenon is driven by trade invoicing in emerging markets and developing countries. So from another study actually I did with some colleagues from the European Stability Mechanism, some of them are present today. So if we look at this binary relationship between the share of exports to the euro area and the invoicing in euro and versus USD, the use of USD versus the share of exports to US, we can see that quite a lot of countries that have very little or small exposure to the US, but tend to use USD for trading. Here you don't see the country names, but many of them so are commodity exporters. They are emerging markets exporting intermediary goods, so on and so forth. So I think this is quite interesting phenomenon to observe. And so one suggestion would be like Cedric, you did for the China part, probably I think it will also be very interesting actually to control for regions as a proxy of different types of commodity exporters. And probably we are going to see interesting results in terms of the use of euro and to explain why the use of euro is more related to the share and that the use of US dollar is not that related actually to the share of exports. Another thing I want to mention about the fundamentals, and here in the title I'm giving, actually I try to emphasize this trade-related fundamentals, because I think there are many things that are, or fundamentals that are beyond trades, which will also condition the use of a invoicing currency. Of course, much of it would be captured by a country fixed effect and time fixed effect, but I think it's worth mentioning, for instance, settlement and clearing infrastructure. In Asia, for instance, the clearing in euro actually started way later than dollar USD clearing, and also the size of offshore currency liquidity. Those are also two points I'm going to come back when I talk about China. So now policies, here in the paper, so the policies refer to swap lines, which are quite interesting. One quick suggestion here is, in the paper, the dummy variable is used to capture the announcement effects, basically, of swap lines. But also in the data set, you have the notional amount. So I think it would be also interesting actually to control for the notional amount instead of owning the swap line, basically the agreement, signing of the agreement. I will come back to explain why. And then one point Cedric has already mentioned, I think RMB swap lines are very particular because they stated actually publicly that there is always a trade dimension to it. So it's more to facilitate the use of RMB outside of China versus USD and Euro swap lines, which are really negotiated in a more crisis management context. So I think this is also something that the paper can highlight a bit more to distinguish these two types of swap lines. So finally, on this, I'm wondering, so maybe there are also other things, other policy initiatives that can play a critical role here, especially the signing of swap lines often came as a package of different policy initiatives from the Chinese side. Especially we can think about the settlement and the clearing infrastructure. For instance, you know, around the same dates or years, China will also announce that the renminbi is included in the basket of reserve management for that foreign central bank, or there is a new clearing commercial bank which is set up in the foreign jurisdiction. So then the question is more about, probably this is a package deal than simply related to swap lines. And in terms of the market infrastructure, I think that could play an even bigger role, because for foreigners, for foreign companies actually to use renminbi for international trade, actually they need either renminbi liquidity overseas for imports, or they need to be willing actually to accept renminbi in terms of export proceeds. So here there are other events like cross-border interbank payment system set up in 2015, which is also a key date. Then I go back to this idea about controlling for offshore RMB liquidity, especially for imports. So here, one exercise I think which would be very interesting to look at is to control for the size of overseas offshore RMB bonds, which are not issued in all the countries that are included in your database, but only in a few of them. So I'm wondering if this could also play a role explaining the use of RMB for trade invoicing. Another thing actually which matters more for a subsample of your subsample of your data concerning African countries mostly, but also a couple of Latin American countries, because as Christoph mentioned, so Exim Bank of China extended loans to those countries, and particularly Exim Bank has a series of loans which is called the government concessional loan, which is denominated in RMB. So these loans, and also to my understanding, actually the money doesn't go out of China, it's like a credit line, but denominating RMB for foreign countries to use to import, right? So this can also increase actually the size, the volume of trading denominated in RMB related to some financial instruments. So this is another suggestion for you to consider. Overall, I think those are only minor points, interesting but minor points, because you can also argue that much of the effects is also controlled for captured actually by country and time fixed effects. But maybe you can discuss them more explicitly in the paper. So I stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gong. So as we are running out of time, I'm just going to take two questions from the audience. You can raise your hand. So Camille has a question.
Thank you very much for this very interesting presentation. So I just had, maybe it's a follow-up question really, but China has created some RMB denominated commodities futures. Do you think this could be a game changer maybe in invoicing of commodities? And then that's in the wake of also what Gong just said, maybe trying to understand what's the first step. Like, I wonder whether it is because countries have strong trade ties and already have some trade in RMB with China that they actually open the swap lines. So that might be an endogeneity issue. I don't know if you have tackled that in your paper, to be honest. So that was my two main points. Thank you very much.
Oh, I don't see.
I also had a question, but I raised my hand, but okay. I don't know if I did it correctly. Maybe I did, I'm not sure. Quickly on taxes, it's a very interesting paper. So, first point, I wanted also to emphasize what Gong said. So, the swap lines in China have a different nature. I would go even beyond what he said. So, I would say these are. Is a signal of political ties, essentially. And so the interpretation of those swap lines cannot be easily extended to the role they have in advanced economies. So I've been wondering if you should not control for that. So better control for political alliances, I don't know, visits of key Chinese policymakers in the country and things like that. I guess that these happen simultaneously. So there must be a high level visit. They can sign trade agreements or then also, you know, have a swap line. So it's part of a package, I suppose. And the second multi-tier point is I seem to remember that part of these swap lines are actually in dollars. I'm not sure about it, but. But I'm not. What I'm saying, I'm not sure that all the PBOC swap lines are actually renminbi. But I might be wrong. But it could be that part of this these are in dollars. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Should I go and answer this?
Yes, you can go in. Thank you.
So, should I go and answer, Sophia? I think I kind of lost the contact with you.
Yes,
for a second.
Yes, my connection was very bad. So you can answer very briefly, please, if you can. Thank you.
Yeah, let me maybe focus. So thanks a lot, Gong, for this very interesting discussion. And yeah, by all means, I mean, the RMB swap are definitely not like a Fed swap. In fact, maybe if it makes this clear, the only swap line we control for are RMB. In this sample, we don't toss its swap line for other countries. But that takes the point, and then when we draw the interpretation, we have to be careful in extending the interpretation to other countries, because it's kind of a specific swap line as part of the broader package. So thanks for the suggestion for the payment system, the bonds there. Maybe I could get back to you for if you can point us to specific data sources where we could get indicators for this. In terms of Livio's question, are they in renminbi? As far as I know, yes, but we'll double check that, definitely. Camille, so we can check for the commodity futures. In terms of the reverse causality, that was, I think given the event studies chart that I showed, it looks like the pickup in the invoicing is following the swap line. So on that, we feel more comfortable, I have to say. So that would be my key answer to the main point. So thanks a lot for the comments, and we'll be in touch for more links to the data sources.
So thank you very much. We reached the end of our session. Let us all thank our speakers and discussant for this very insightful session on the internationalization of the renminbi. Thank you very much.